Krishan is a young Tamil man from the south of Sri Lanka, from Colombo, who spent many years in India studying, and he chooses to return at some point a few years after the end of the war because of a kind of guilt that develops in him. Like many Tamils who weren't directly in the war zone, he spent days and weeks obsessing over footage, online videos, pictures taken by survivors on their cameras that kind of showed the horror of the last 2 years of the war in Sri Lanka in 2008 and 2009. He moves back with this guilt, out of this hope that he can change things or contribute to growth in this destroyed society, but obviously such a thing is not possible. And so the novel meets Krishan at this time of disillusionment. The novel moves from the south of the country to the north, which is to say from the part of the country that was not affected directly by the war to the part of the country that was totally destroyed by war. Krishan has been obsessing over what happened during the war for many years, and it creates a kind of cognitive dissonance in him, a sense inside of the world having collapsed, of the world having been destroyed, when nothing in his external environment, neither in Colombo nor in Delhi, where he spends many years, reflects this collapse. This cognitive dissonance, this dissonance between inside and outside, is one of the themes of the novel, and it shows as he moves from the south of the country towards the northeast, where, in a strange way, even though society has been destroyed, even though people's bodies have been destroyed, even though their homes have been destroyed, even though this destruction is so visible and palpable, it almost creates a kind of calm in him. It soothes him in a way to be in a place where the outside reflects how he feels inside. So the novel is a kind of movement from south to north, but it's also a movement through different parts of Krishan's psyche. As he moves, as the environment outside changes him, certain parts of his own mental life become more salient, and certain other parts seem to fall away. And for Krishan, those parts that come to the surface as he travels northeast are, in some sense, the truest part of reality. There's a technical reason there's no dialogue. That's because in Tamil, obviously, like in any other language, there is a range of registers and dialects that mark out your region, your caste, and your class position. And there's no way to bring these into English without using the models of dialect available in English. Which would be, different kinds of dialect in northern UK or in the southern United States, all of which have very particular associations. So if I bring dialogue, so there's no choice but to use standard English if I want to avoid these very different cultural associations. And so everything becomes flattened. Dialogue becomes flattened in English from a language like Tamil. And so I chose to avoid dialogue altogether rather than engage in the fiction that there is this unified, coherent, undivided society. And I think there's another reason that has to do with, I guess, something closer to me, which is simply a certain kind of skepticism about what people have to say. There are a certain kind of writers that look for the gaps in people's speech, look for the lies or the hesitations or the pauses, and try to find the truth behind their speech in those moments. But that requires a lot of patience that I don't have, and so I often prefer to ignore what people have to say for themselves. I studied philosophy for many years, Western philosophy. I guess one way you can characterize the tradition is as a search for a kind of intellectual sense of safety or security or liberation from the difficulties and oppressions of ordinary life. And the more one studies philosophy, I mean, the distinctions, the conceptualizations of various phenomena of ordinary life can be very illuminating, I suppose, and it did enrich my life, I think, for a long time. But in philosophy, there's this sense that the answer to the various problems of life are statable in the form of simple declarative sentences that can be either true or false, and that we can give a justification for or against. But the more time I spent studying philosophy, especially what's called analytic philosophy, which is the dominant tradition in English language philosophy, the more I realized that what I'm looking for when I am looking for answers in philosophy is not so much a set of statements as a kind of mood, a mood that I can internalize, a mood that offers me a possibility for life, a way of dealing with the people and things and difficulties I encounter. And philosophy, at least again in the English tradition, is supposed to be abstracted from mood. It's supposed to be neutral. It's supposed to be not colored in a way, although everything is always colored by mood. Whereas literature and the novel is built around moods, is built around states of mind that make certain phenomena more salient and that make certain phenomena fall away. And I realized that a lot of the questions I had for how to conduct myself, these are questions that I think a young person is more likely to ask, and that I ask myself now a little bit less, is something that could, literature is something that could offer me a mood. It could offer me different ways of life, because you sit with a book for so long, you have a chance to internalize it. While you sit with the book, you see the world through the mood of the book. And for me, this is a real ethical possibility. This offers real ethical choice for us. And so I think that's why I switched to literature.